Emotional eating and oral personality type. Why people eat more than they need. Hi guys, my name is Elena Semenek and this is my YouTube channel Psychology of Happiness. Welcome! If you're new to my channel, please consider subscribing so you won't miss any of my future self-development webinars and self-improvement videos. Today we will talk about emotional eating and overeating problem. We will discuss oral personality type, and I'm one of those people with oral personality type. I will tell you my personal story, how I gained a lot of weight and what I did in order to lose this excess weight. I'm a psychologist and a life coach. If you would like to know more about my education, please visit my website www.elenasemenek.com. You can find more about me on my website and about work that I do, about private sessions and free webinars like this one. Let's start this webinar. If I ask you to name the most famous psychologist, the majority will say Sigmund Freud. Sigmund Freud was born on May 6, 1856 in a Jewish family and spent most of his time in Vienna, Austria. He fled the Nazi occupation in the early days of World War II and arrived in London where he spent the rest of his life. He was the founder and the father of psychoanalysis. Psychoanalysis is one of the biggest branches of psychology. Psychoanalysis is a method for treating through dialogue between a patient and a therapist. Sigmund Freud was a celebrity in his time and was recognized by people on the street. He was also a controversial figure. He had huge ambitions, he was often dishonest, extremely brutal to his friends and terrible to his enemies. Freud was the first to state that our unconscious motives control our behavior. Not our conscious mind, but our unconscious mind. Freud was a genius and, at the same time, he was hated by many for his views and his theories. One of the biggest things that Freud brought to the world of psychology is his psychosexual theory of human development. He introduced the term psychosexual stages. He believed that a child's life is built around the concept of tension and pleasure. Pleasure he called the libido energy. I'm sure most of you have heard about that word before. Freud's theory based on the correlation between tension, or other words stress, and the amount of pleasure that a child experiences in his childhood. These two main factors control our behavior and makes us who we are. Freud's whole theory of psychoanalysis is centered around our childhood. Everything is rooted in our childhood, including our self-esteem, self-love, self-acceptance, ability to trust others, and ability to achieve our goals. We all went through specific stages of development. Freud called those stages psychosexual stages. Psycho is referred to our mind. Sexual refers to libido, the feeling of pleasure. If something goes wrong in one of those stages, if a child experiences too much tension or too much pleasure, he will be stuck in his childhood trauma and develop what Freud called a fixation. Fixation in childhood always has a lasting effect in adulthood. The right amount of pleasure and stress creates a healthy psyche, a healthy person. We need both. We need pleasure and stress in order to create a healthy psyche. Each of our childhood stages is associated with a specific age and a specific conflict that has to be resolved. In other words, a child should learn a specific task in each stage. Like in school, before going to the second grade, we have to learn the material from the first grade. Then a child can successfully move to the next grade or to the next psychological stage. If a child does not pass the stage successfully, does not learn the material from the first grade, then he will have problems in the second grade. Same with our psyche. Freud believed that the first 5 years of our life is crucial to the formation of adult personality. Again, if we can compare this system with our school system, the first five grades are very, very important. If you don't learn how to read and write, if you don't learn basic math, you will have problems later in your middle school and high school. There are a total of five psychological stages that we all go through in our childhood. The best way to remember them is by the phrase, old age parrots love grapes. Old stands for oral stage, age stands for anal stage, parrots stand for phallic state, love stands for latent stage or latent period, and grapes stands for genital stage. Freud's followers expanded his theory, and today I will share with you the expanded version. The first, the foundational stage, is the oral stage. This stage is 100% related to our topic of overeating. The fixation on this stage can cause eating addictions, smoking, alcoholism, biting fingernails, chewing toothpicks or pencils. People who use lots of sarcasm in their life also might have a fixation on this stage, because sarcasm is kind of a symbolically biting humor. Again, fixation means that the child had some type of a problem or trauma in his childhood and was not able to pass this oral stage successfully. Breastfeeding is the main component for a newborn to pass this stage successfully. The part of the body where a child receives the biggest pleasure is his mouth. The oral stage of psychosexual development starts from the birth and goes till 12-18 months. A child enjoys sucking mommy's breast, a bottle, a blanket, or a toy. He puts everything in his mouth. Taking a child away from his mother's breast too early can lead to serious addictions later. For example, in adulthood, a person might develop problems with weight. Overeating and underweight problems can both be tied to this period. Let me tell you my personal story. I smoked cigarettes for more than 15 years. Smoking is another type of oral addiction because it's also related to our mouth. That was my method of managing stress and anxiety in my life. I tried to quit many times. A few times I was able to stay without cigarettes for 2-3 months. And then I was drawn back to them. My dad, my brother, most of my friends were smokers. It was the easiest way for me to manage stress and to hide my emotions. When I finally quit smoking, I gained 14 pounds within less than 6 months. I was going to the gym 3-4 times a week and tried to eat healthy. I tried different diets, I tried different exercises, but I always ate more than I needed, especially before bedtime. I replaced one oral addiction, smoking, with another oral addiction, the overeating. That was the only way for me to quit smoking. Extra weight was never a problem for me before. I did not believe that people cannot manage their weight. But once I stopped smoking, I realized that diet and exercise alone don't work for me. I had to dig deeper and find the cause of my overeating problem. For 2 years, I've been learning and researching about psychological reasons for overeating. I tried different psychological methods and exercises. I was learning how to identify my emotions, how to deal with them in a healthy way, and how to express my feelings in a healthy way instead of suppressing them with cigarette or with food. Once I stopped smoking, I realized that I was a very anxious person, and for many years I was using unhealthy defense mechanisms to suppress my feelings and hide my true emotions. Because I smoke a cigarette every hour or so, I did not even notice the level of stress that I had. I had to admit to myself that being in my 30s, with a bachelor's degree in psychology, with more than 200 hours of personal therapy and workshops, online trainings, I was not able to manage my emotions in a healthy way. I was avoiding them and suppressing them with cigarettes and later with food. Now I consider myself to be an expert in overeating psychology. Not only I know the theory about overeating psychology, but I have learned from my own personal experience. I struggled for 2 years. I was able to find the reasons, the true reasons for my overeating or oral addiction. I was able to lose most of my excess weight. I still have 4 pounds to reach my goal, to reach my ideal weight, and I'm still working on myself. It's not easy. I want to be honest with you. It's not easy, and it will take time. But I'm so happy. I'm glad that I decided to take the journey and to step on that path of self-discovery. Today, as I have lost the extra weight, the excess weight, I have gained many unexpected benefits along the way. Lots of insights have came to my mind during my journey. I was able to address my psychological issues related to overeating, and I was able to improve the relationships with myself, with my friends, and I was able to improve my romantic relationships as well. Now I can understand myself better. When I want to eat crackers or nuts, or when I want to chew chicken wings or meat from the bone, I know that I'm trying to suppress my anger. When I want to eat salty food, I know that it's time for me to pay attention to my inner critic. If you would like to know more about how to identify your emotions by the type of food you eat, please watch my webinar entitled Tell Me What You Eat, and they will tell you what problems you have. The link is in the video description. If you like this video so far, please give me a thumbs up and consider subscribing with hitting the notification bell. I release 2-3 videos every week, so by clicking this notification bell, by subscribing, you will not miss any of my future videos. Let's get back to today's topic, oral personality type. People with an oral personality type have 2 main things that they have to work on. 1, they have to learn how to identify and express their hidden emotions. 2, they need to work on their personal boundaries so they can address their trust issues. Let's talk more about why people might have trust issues in romantic relationships and how this is related to food. A child is completely dependent on his mother during the first year of his life. His mother is his world. This is the stage when a child is learning on a cellular level if they can trust other people or not. His mother is the representation of all people and the outside world itself. The foundation of trust is being built when the baby feels his mother's body while she is breastfeeding him or just holding him in her arms. If a mother abandoned her child or a baby was separated from the mother because of medical reasons, they cannot develop healthy physical contact. Instead, they experience what is called in psychology abandonment trauma. This child will likely have trust issues when they grow up. Let me share with you my personal story. I was born in Russia. When I was born, babies were separated from their mothers immediately after birth. All newborns were taken to a separate room. They were spent several days in their own tiny beds and were given to their mothers only for feeding. There were only a couple nurses taking care of 10 to 15 babies at once. Of course, these babies did not receive enough love and care. Every baby had a tag that helped the nurses to identify their mothers. Later in my life, my mom told me a story about that one day a nurse brought me for feeding to another woman by mistake. In the United States, the paid maternity leave is very short. Most women must come back to their job within 12 weeks to keep their position. 12 weeks is about 3.5 months. This is not enough for mother-child bonding. When mother goes to work, many newborns can experience emotional abandonment by their mothers. Fathers, grandparents, nannies, and preschool can only partially replace the mother's love. As a result, we have lots of women and men who have problems with commitment. We don't trust each other. We are afraid to be vulnerable. We don't feel safe to express our true emotions and feelings. In the United States, about 35% of adults are diagnosed with obesity. Food is one of the easiest ways to suppress our emotions. Let's talk a little bit more about the importance of mother-child emotional bonding and how it is related to food. Most of you have probably heard about postpartum depression, a condition where mothers cannot take care of their babies for several days, sometimes weeks and even months. This can create abandonment trauma in a child's psyche. The first emotional contact is a reciprocal smile, which happens between the first and second month of a baby's life. If the mother shows her emotional connection with the baby, then the child develops a sense of love and security. Love and security are two most important things for every baby to experience in order for him to create a healthy psyche. The first conscious anxiety of the absence of the mother develops around at the age of 7 months, and conscious fear of strangers develops at 8 months. This is another important period when mother should be very careful when she leaves her baby with a nanny, grandparents, or at a preschool. This should be a process of gradual and safe separation. A baby must learn that his mom is always coming back. The mother should start with a small windows of separation and gradually increase it. On average, 7 to 9 months old babies are extremely sensitive to the development of any type of anxiety, stress, and fear. At this age, we form three important beliefs that will impact the rest of our lives. 1. The world is a safe place to live, or the world is a dangerous place to live. 2. I can trust people, or I cannot trust people because they might abandon me. 3. The world is an abundant place, or the world has limited resources. If a baby had a limited amount of emotional contact with his mother during the first year of his life, then there is a high chance that this child will develop a trust issue growing up. This child might, 1. Struggle with making good friends at school, 2. Get involved with a bad crowd during their teenage years, 3. End up in a toxic romantic relationship, 4. Have a hard time creating committed relationships in the future, 5. Have issues with colleagues at work and problems with working in a team. 6. Develop a good girl, good boy syndrome, also known as a savior syndrome. 7. Develop an overeating problem. There are just few possible scenarios. Let's talk more about how people develop a neural personality type. Sigmund Freud was the first to introduce the concept of the oral stage of child development into the world of psychology. He used the word fixation to explain what happens with the psyche when a child has problems in this stage. A child might develop an oral fixation when he does not receive enough milk. This could occur in a few different scenarios. 1. A child has a problem sucking the nipple. 2. A mother does not generate enough milk. 3. A mother does not hold her baby while feeding. She gives him a bottle and the baby does not create an emotional connection with her. 4. A baby has to be tube fed because he was born immature or has other medical problems. All these factors might create an oral fixation and cause a child to develop an oral personality. People with an oral personality can be divided into two main groups. First one, those who develop a passive dependency, and the second group are those who develop an aggressive dependency. When a child does not receive enough milk or the mother does not feed him on time, a child might lay down quietly waiting for his mother. He might cry a bit, but most of the time he will be passive, waiting for his mother. This child will develop a passive dependency. An opposite reaction, when a child cries loudly and excessively, he demands his mother's attention. This is his way of asking to be fed. This child will bite his mother's breast if there is not enough milk. This child will likely develop an aggressive type of dependency. The way a child communicates with the mother is the foundation of how he will communicate with other people when he grows up. So let's talk more about passive and aggressive dependency. Examples of passive dependency in adulthood: smoking or an alcohol addiction. A person protects quietly, suppressing his emotions with alcohol or with cigarettes. Eating problems. A person overeats or does not eat enough food. Again, this is a passive protest. A person does not express his emotions. He is suppressing them with food. Please watch my two other free webinars that are already on YouTube. One, Food as a Substitute for Love. And two, Emotional Eating. Tell me what you eat and I will tell you what problems you have. The third example of passive dependency is love addiction. This refers to people who end up in toxic relationships, dependent relationships, relationships with a narcissistic person, long-distance relationship, or a situation of unrequited or one-sided love. Often a person struggles in the relationship but is afraid to leave their partner. This person hopes that one day their partner will change and love them the way they feel they deserve. This person is afraid to be single. Remember, we spoke about the abandonment trauma with the mother. This person subconsciously is afraid to leave this type of toxic relationships because the pain from his childhood is hidden so deep inside of him and his psyche does not want to face it again. The person will stay in those toxic relationships until they experience a bigger pain than their fear of abandonment. Many times a person might hit rock bottom before they realize that this time they have to leave. Please click the like button if you understand what I'm talking about. Please share your questions and your stories in the comments. I really appreciate when you share your thoughts under my videos. Please don't be afraid to open up. I'm here to help you on your self-development journey. If you don't write your comments, if you don't share your story, then it's not possible for me to support you. I release a new video 2-3 times a week. I do Q&A videos where I answer your questions. Please consider subscribing and clicking the notification bell so you won't miss any future free self-development webinars and educational videos. Let's continue talking about the oral fixation and discuss the second type of dependency, which is aggressive dependency. Examples of aggressive dependency. When a child is sucking his mother's nipple and not getting enough milk, he becomes hungry and aggressive. The child has to use a physical force in order to receive food. Subconsciously, he develops an internal belief that he must be aggressive in order to achieve what he wants. He must be aggressive in order to get what he wants. He must be aggressive in order for other people to hear and to notice him. In order to reach his goal, he must use all of his power and might even be violent, or he might be left with nothing. He has to demand what he wants. He has to be in control of the situation. He has to create fights and arguments all the time. Examples of people with aggressive dependency: a person who creates fights over small things. A person who likes to argue and won't stop until other people agree with him. A person who likes aggressive sports like MMA and boxing. A person who likes sarcasm and offensive jokes. A person who likes to abuse others to meet his own ends. A person who creates an emotional roller coaster in relationships. This person likes drama and conflict. This type of person can joke saying there is nothing better than a sex after the big fight. And for them, it's true. Conflicts in romantic relationships can really spice up their sex life. Of course, some people can be more aggressive than others. It depends on the rules and traditions that the child was raised in. Aggressive and passive dependency can be also developed when the mother overfeeds the baby, when mother cannot understand if a baby is full or not. In this situation, we can also develop two types of reaction. One, a baby might continue eating even if he is already full, and that's why we eat more than we need. Two, a child might bite his mother's breast or throw food to show his protest. And this way, the child will develop an aggressive type of dependency, aggressive personality. Please watch my free webinars entitled Food as a Universal Remedy. In this webinar, I talk about how we get emotionally attached to food from the moment we're born through our childhood and teenage years into adult life. I share a lot of stories and examples in this webinar. Again, the name of the webinar is Food as a Universal Remedy for Better and for Worse. The link is below the video. Please watch it after this one. So let's summarize. We all went through the oral stage of psychosexual development when we were babies, from 0 to 18 months of our life. Some of us went through this stage more successfully than others. Any interruptions on this stage, physical, medical, or emotional, creates a mark on our psyche. Our self-esteem problems, the ability to trust other people, the ability to be vulnerable in relationships, and the ability to create healthy boundaries can be traced back to our emotional and physical connection with our mother during the first year of our life. Fixation on the oral stage leads to two types of dependency: passive dependency and aggressive dependency. If in your adulthood you have a hard time managing your overeating habits, if you cannot create lasting romantic relationships, or if you end up in a toxic relationship, then maybe it's time for you to consider working on your emotional problems and healing your inner critics. Today, I would like to invite you to a wonderful journey of internal transformation. I would like to invite you to my 12-week online course, Weight Loss Vaccine. In this course, you will learn how to identify your emotions, how to deal with anger, how to be the boss of your own life. This is going to be your self-development and self-discovery journey. As you've learned today, overeating habits relate not only to our emotions, but also to how we build relationships with other people in our life. In the online course, Weight Loss Vaccine, you will also learn how overeating is related to sexuality and to money. If you would like to know more about this 12-week healing online course, please check the link in the video description. You won't find this information anywhere else. I used a lot of different resources to create my webinars and this online course. Think about it like a 1,000-piece puzzle, which covers different areas in your life. This is a unique course that will help you to improve many aspects of your life. Everything is inside you. If you are willing to work on yourself, then I'm here to guide and support you. Again, watch my other 4 webinars about emotional eating. Those 4 webinars are absolutely free. And of course, consider enrolling in my 12-week online course, Weight Loss Vaccine. All links are below. This online course is not about dieting, is not about exercising, is not about counting calories. This is about you, about healing your childhood trauma, about managing your emotions in a healthy way so you can become happier and more successful in life. Again, my name is Elena Semenek. If you like this video, if you've learned something today, please give me a thumbs up. Please share this video with your friends. Help me to promote my channel. Share it with your loved ones. Share it with your coworkers, with your neighbors. Send it to people that might be interested in this information. And please ask your questions, write your comments in the comment section under this video. Thank you very much for watching. Until next time, bye.